In neighboring Sudan, dozens of journalists marched in Khartoum Monday demanding an end to a crackdown on press freedom amidst the most sustained challenge to Sudanese President Omar al-Bashir since he took power in a 1989 coup. Protesters have been demonstrating in the streets frequently across Sudan since December. The marches were triggered by price hikes and cash shortages, but evolved into demonstrations against President Bashir and his National Congress Party. Monday's protest carried a large banner that read, "Press, Free Press or No Press," as they walked down a main street in the capital. Since the wave of demonstrations began, 90 journalists have been detained, according to the Sudanese Journalists Network, but most of them have since been released. Now, for more on the crackdown on journalists, I'm joined by Azaz Elshami, a Sudanese-American human rights advocate and journalist. Azaz, welcome to Africa 54.
Thank you, Esther, for having me.
Now, this is another threat to the press. When the president declared a state of emergency in Sudan, he also said he had this conciliatory tone saying the demands of the people are lawful. What changed?
I don't think the president is ever sincere in what he says. It's only just for consumption and to appease those who are in his side. And as for the press, it's always been under attack prior to this protest and leading up to the protest and now during the protest. In the early days, I think early January, most of the international press and journalists were not allowed to work. They were asked to leave production houses that would host them. They were also closed down. Newspaper that are functioning in Sudan were also on constant confiscation, censorship, arrest. Osman Mirghani is the editor-in-chief of Al-Tayar, has been arrested since 22nd of February. His family does not know about his whereabouts and his health condition. It's a systematic thing. Journalists who cover the protests are arrested, sometimes for 3 hours, sometimes on days on end. Their mobiles are searched, their laptops are searched.
What do they fear? What is the fear? Why fear the journalists?
This is a dictatorship. They do not want, they always downplay the number of the people on the streets. They do not want to give it a legitimacy. They always say that these are just like bored young students or something like that. They do not want it to be something seen by the majority. They do not want to document it. It's part of the systematic oppression on all voices, whether they're in the streets, they're met with bullets. If they are in print, they're gonna be confiscated. They want to impose one narrative. That is what the state wants to say, and they do not want to be anything out there. And it's not only about the protest. There's so many red tapes in Sudan, and it's part of a bigger scheme that controls the press in Sudan.
But we note that the protests are not a daily occurrence as it was before. Did this change because of the state of emergency, or why is it not as sustained as we saw since December?
It's actually a strategic decision on the part of the Sudanese Professional Association. They did not want it to for the crowd to feel the fatigue. So what they've been doing, they've been streamlining it. So on Sundays and Thursdays, usually these are the big marches and processions. And then there are night protests that are happening. And then there's on Friday, they do mobilization. In the past couple of weeks, they had like disobedience, call for disobedience, one day strike. So they've been actually diversifying their nonviolent resistance action tactics, but it was not subsiding or for loss of interest or enthusiasm on the part of the protesters. It's actually a tactic so they can have longevity and persistence.
Now, very quickly, the Human Rights Watch is calling on Tunisia not to allow President al-Bashir to attend the Arab League summit this coming Sunday, or to arrest him if he enters Tunisia, because he is wanted by the ICC for, you know, crimes against humanity. Do you think Tunisia is going to heed this call?
Well, they should, because they are signatory to Rome Statute, and their representative did confirm their commitment to ICC, and this is not for the first time that al-Bashir is going to be in such a debacle. It happened to him when he was in South Africa. It happened to him when he went to Nigeria. And sometimes he says that just to put a brave face. And sometimes he say, I'm going to attend, and then end up not going. So he might not go. And I think Tunisia will be rightly so to arrest him.
And we'll wait and see.
That would be the right thing to do.
Azaz, thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.
Azaz Elshami is a Sudanese-American human rights advocate and a journalist.